Welcome to the first ever episode of Zootopica. This is a podcast where everything zoology, from the latest scientific research to day-to-day life to pop culture, everything meets. Now, I'm Ruchira Somaweera. I'm a scientist and an explorer, and I'll be your host. Joining me on every episode is a non-sciencey friend of mine. And to kick this off, I have Ewa Miszczak.
Hi. Pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting me to your podcast.
Thank you for joining. You're not from a science background.
No, far from it. Really far from it.
What do you do?
I'm a lawyer by background, but the good kind, I would say.
That's assuring.
Zero education in zoology, biology, anything scientific related. Over to you for your expertise on this.
But still, I think we share some passions for travel. Tropics.
Yes.
You worked in the tropics for a while.
Oh gosh, like this guy from the Komodo Islands. Does he have a name yet?
We don't, but that's going to be our mascot.
Awesome.
That, because Komodo is one place that I absolutely love, and that's from the Komodo village.
Best water, I would say, in the world. The best tropics, the best fish, amazing islands.
Science bit. The ocean around that region is called Wallacea, has the highest diversity of corals anywhere in the world.
That's why it's so beautiful.
Absolutely.
Cool.
Ewa, do you want to explain how we are going to make this work?
Yes. So Dr. Ru over here really wants to share his knowledge, and he has accumulated years of knowledge. He's published books. He's got roomfuls of all of his publications. And it's great that you're doing this to educate people like me and others out there that don't really know enough about this but love the planet Earth. And we've, before this show, submitted some input, or others have submitted some input for us to give us a list of questions that came from you, the audience, to cover on this particular topic. And the topic that was picked for the show for this evening is the beginning of life on Earth. Very interesting.
I thought that is a good start.
Yeah, it's a good one. Yeah. I like it.
So, as Ewa said,
beginning.
Every week I'll post a theme for that week. And we have been getting questions from Instagram and Twitter. Ru Somaweera. You'll see that in the title.
Hard to spell.
Yes. Is Sri Lanka.
Is the
handle. And on Facebook, I'm quite active on Facebook as a science communication tool.
Right.
So the whole idea is that I want to take zoology to the general public, science for the general public. So you are representing the general public.
Awesome.
And that's why I need a non-sciencey friend. Aww. So you can ask all the questions that they are not here to ask.
Thank you for that. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here. Should we kick it off?
Let's do it.
Okay.
First ever.
So the first question that I'm going to throw your way is from Samantha. From Perth, which is coincidentally exactly where we are right now. So a fellow neighbor has a question for you.
Awesome.
And the question is there any credible evidence to show that scientists have created life artificially in a lab? Oh, that's a controversial question.
It's a theme of many movies. Most movies go wrong. In the movies, that is.
Oh, are you predicting the future for us now?
So when you say artificial life, that can be interpreted in many ways. So if you are expecting life to be this creature that runs around, no, scientists have not reached that. We haven't created that a conscious living thing.
Okay.
Because that's a complicated thing. It's not just a bunch of molecules together. There are biological processes like compartmentalization, all this serious stuff, right?
Okay.
Metabolism, information transfer, all those procedures or processes have not been still programmed into a living thing.
Mm-hmm.
So we are far from that, but we have top people working on that.
Mm.
But creating life can be done with other means, like everything from GMOs, your genetically modified organisms.
Thank you for defining that for people like me.
So GMOs, or genetically modified organisms, hybrids there's technology called CRISPR now, where we can actually gene edit.
Yeah.
So
is that not new?
It has been there for a few years.
No, what I mean is that not new life? Because we're mucking around with existing life and creating something new.
Absolutely. So that's why I said like it depends on how you define artificial life. Like this, the term synthetic life has come to existence now.
Yep.
Or in my opinion, these are artificial life forms. These are not naturally found out there.
Yep.
Like the big cats. Do you know your big cats?
No.
Name few.
A safari cat.
No, I don't know. One.
A leopard.
Okay, leopard.
Leopard,
yeah.
Is a cat.
Yeah. Lions.
Lions.
Your tigers.
Other than that,
your jaguars and your snow leopard. So those five are the big cats, right?
Okay.
But people have crossed all five big cats.
They have. Yeah. One of my best friends, hi, if you're watching this, I will not name you, just bought a cheetah cross.
So a lot of cats have been interbred,
they're
right?
They're insane.
They're hybrids. There's that Netflix series.
That's our wine.
That is our wine.
We're going to call this interference. Let's just run with it.
Yeah? Absolutely.
And talk about cheetahs and then go and have our wine.
Going back to the question, yes, we have not created life that runs around, but we have now have the technology to edit the genome of an animal, right? The genome is your script. It's the plan of an animal. It tells you, it's the order of all the genes that tells, okay, this is how this animal is going to turn out.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
So there's only four bases. Bases are the building block of life, ATGC in general, we call them. People now can actually move this around and have played with that.
Yep.
Right? So, yeah, we are on track and certain advances have been made, but no, we have not created artificial life from scratch that runs around. But in other means, we have crossed and we have gene edited and made new life forms.
That's really cool. So this guy here, the mascot that we see here, this could be one of the children of the dragons from the Game of Thrones without the wings that's evolved over time.
We need to do a completely different episode of mythical creatures.
I think we should.
Yeah, we should actually.
I think this guy's here to stay and we're going to have a lot of content.
So just because you mentioned the name dragon comes because the first ever Europeans reached Flores and the Indonesian islands that have dragons, they could not, because of their size and the shape, they could not think of anything from Europe that they have seen to relate to that. So that's where the name dragon originated.
Huh.
Yeah.
Okay.
There you go.
Very cool. So let's move on to the next question then, which is somewhat related but on a different tangent.
Mm-hmm.
So we have Samantha from Sri Lanka.
Oh, interesting.
From Colombo, that has sent through a question for you, Dr. Ru. As a biologist, you must be in constant conflict with religions like Christianity, which says that life was created by a super being instead of originating and evolving. How do you deal with this conflict?
Okay, so, all right, so Samantha or Samantha, that's how you pronounce that in Sinhala, in Sri Lanka.
Okay.
Okay, so basically I don't have a conflict because I, as a scientist, I don't believe in a divine power creating life. I go with the objective truth when there's scientific evidence.
Okay.
So that, and I have zero problem with anyone believing in that. That's your personal choice, right?
Yep.
But and I respect that, and I see the need of religion and all these beliefs because it's asking about my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
In science, you have methods and tools now to put a timeline as to when life originated on Earth and how it evolved.
Okay.
So we have things like carbon dating, isotope studies, which you can date fossils back, and the results we get predate what some of these religions believe. Like, it's not thousands, it's in millions of years.
Oh, okay.
Right? So we have very solid evidence from scientific means to show these life forms are millions of years old. And then we have other genetic tools, for example, comparative anatomy. These are all scientific tools and methods that shows how animals diverge and evolve. So we can compare fossil records to existing animals and say, okay, this many million years ago, this animal diverged, right? So these timelines do not tally with some of what some of the main religions say.
Okay.
And because of all those scientific objective evidence, I personally go with that. I personally don't have a conflict with what other religions mention. But just on that, because Christianity was mentioned, Christianity is absolutely not the only religion that it's probably one of the main ones that we discuss about because of Genesis and all that. But pretty much all mainstream religions, from Judaism to Islam to Hinduism, all these religions have some form of mentioning about how life evolved. Mm. And these are fascinating. These are absolutely fascinating. But personally, I go with what science says. And science says, put dates into things, show mechanisms, how they have been evolved and how they have originated. So because of that objective body of evidence, I go with that.
I like your answer.
Yeah.
What I find interesting is that time is a construct that man created.
True.
Right? So if we define what you just mentioned being hinged upon time, then are we kind of going in a circle? Because...
Not really, because the time is only one of them. The other one is because I think it's about origin and evolution, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Evolution is undeniable. We have all these records to show this form turned into this to this.
Yeah,
to that,
okay.
Right? If everything was created at once.
So this is really cool. So my theory, I know this is not a question for me, but is it possible that I'll throw this question at you? Is it possible that God created a monkey? And the monkey or the gorilla then evolved into the human that we are today. Yeah.
It's a very common thing to say that we evolved from monkeys and apes, right? Absolutely not the case. We had what we call a common ancestor. So there was, imagine there was a humanoid, like something that looks like a primate. Okay, even before that, something that's a primate. A primate is, we all are primates, right? So there was this ancient primate that diverged into different groups, right? So a monkey, an ancient monkey, never became an ape and then a human. An ancient monkey became a more developed, evolved monkey, and then monkeys evolved that way. Apes evolved this way. Humans had another branch. So there was a common ancestor, true, but that was not a monkey. That was a common primate.
So the common primate, does he or she have a name?
Okay, it depends on how far you go. So if you just go back the human line, like there are so many fossil records and there are names. So and there's the, like, I'm sure a lot of you have heard of the Neanderthal man, right?
Yeah.
So Homo neanderthalensis, humans. Now everyone listening, who can understand this, belongs to Homo sapien, the modern human.
Yep.
So it's not true that Neanderthal, there was Homo erectus and then there was Neanderthal and sapien. That's not true. These were all different branches. At one point on Earth, there was Homo sapiens, us, Homo neanderthalensis. It's another type of human. It's not an ancient type.
There's other humans out there.
Other species of human, right? Imagine.
What?
Like,
so, other species? What?
Yeah, yeah. So you and I are...
Is this aliens now? Are we going to move into the...
No. It's not, absolutely not. But like you and I, although all these differences, like from our cultural background, from our everything background, we still are in the same species.
I have hair. You've lost yours. Yep.
Absolutely. Thinking too much.
thinking not enough.
Long too. But then Homo neanderthalensis was a completely different type of human, right? And Hobbit, you have heard of Hobbit.
Yeah,
obviously.
I've heard of Hobbit.
Okay. Hobbit, the origin of Hobbit actually is a human.
New Zealand Hobbiton.
See, that's the thing. It's a funny thing that Lord of the Rings is based on New Zealand, but Hobbits, the word hobbit comes from another type of human called Homo florentiensis, which lives in Indonesia. So Frodo was actually Indonesian, not Maori, no.
No way.
Absolutely. So at one point, there were few different types of humans walking on Earth.
That's cool.
Yeah, exactly. So we have evidence for this.
I just thought that it was all part of our humanity and we just evolved in different ways. Some of us have different colored skin, we have different heights, we have different languages. I just thought that we were all part of the same evolutionary path though as humans.
For our species, yes. So we all originated from one single species, but But the common held belief, like even in textbooks, in government textbooks, like at high school level, you'll have this evolution of human from this ape-like thing crawling, and then they're standing up gradually, and then you have the Neanderthal man, and blah. That's actually not true. That was, it was called a linear evolution, one way, right? But what we believe now, or what if science shows now, that's the beauty of science. Science evolves, right? So what we know now, it's that's not the case. It's not like this became this, became this, became this.
Right.
It's like this became so many different versions.
Very cool.
There you go.
Learning all sorts of new things here. So then,
I'm glad.
Then I think we could potentially segue into another question. This one is from California. Remy is asking about what is the most alien life form that has ever evolved on Earth?
Wow, okay. When you hear alien, what comes to your mind?
Another planet, non-human.
Not from Earth, eh?
Not from Earth.
Not from Earth. Okay, so
I'm thinking green beings, big eyes.
Massive eyes.
Coming down, wanting to do experiments on us, taking us on their spaceships.
See, Hollywood movies have had an awesome impact on how humans see the world.
Yeah, it's Wikipedia. It's all this stuff.
We are so going to do an episode on blockbusters and biology.
That would be fun.
Let's do that. So yeah, so alien life form. I believe that Remy's referring to what's the most unusual form. Like if you say like, oh, you look like an alien, that's like unusual, right? So the thing is that the Earth has about 6 to 9 million different types of animals, like kingdom animalia. That's like these estimations, right? Based on best guesses. So when you have that many critters out there, obviously there are going to be odd things, right?
Yeah.
There are going to be things that you're like, what the? Like it just
every time I see a spider.
Exactly. So like it does not look something from this Earth.
Yeah.
I mean, some of the life forms like corals.
Underwater is phenomenal.
Awesome.
They all look like aliens to me, by the way.
I mean, you go diving.
Oh.
Yeah. Some of the things you see underwater does not look anything like an animal.
No, it glows in the dark.
Exactly.
It's got 10 tentacles. Exactly.
and not even that. Sometimes you are not sure whether it's a plant or a stick or a rock.
Yes.
Like coral.
Yes.
A huge example, right?
Yes.
But see, so coral is actually made out of, like, imagine a jellyfish upside down. Instead of going this way, tentacles up.
Yep.
These are teeny weeny things called polyps. They live with this buddy. They have a buddy, an algae, that brings the color. That's why they comes in all sorts of colors. Now, I mean, how weird is that?
Yeah.
When you see that, when you see a rock, a coral, like you don't see, oh, wow, that's actually an awesome animal, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you see that as things that other animals live on.
Yep.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, it can be pretty freaky when you're underwater, thinking that you're next to a rock.
Exactly.
All of a sudden, these eyes start blinking.
Exactly. So, I mean, underwater, like, so pointing out what's the most alien form of life is so hard.
But I, as
a scientist, think in a different way. But so, because if you have to pinpoint, okay, this animal is weird than this, there's no ending. There's some absolute shockers out there. But one thing that's common to all these life forms, including you and me, is that, what do we breathe and use?
Oxygen.
So we use oxygen as the main source of energy, right? We are oxygen dependent creatures.
Yep.
That 6 million things that I talk about, they all use oxygen as the primary energy source. Here on Earth itself, there are life forms that don't need oxygen.
Okay.
Right? That kind of challenge how we define life.
So you're calling them aliens?
If I have to name an alien, like for me, I mean, because there are so many planets without oxygen, right?
Yep.
So maybe there are life forms like these elsewhere. Because like, she's from where is she?
California.
So in California, it's a good example itself. Like Mono Lake in California has this weird bacteria and cyanobacteria. These are single cell stuff.
Okay.
They are having a party in this arsenic and phosphate. These are toxic chemicals. Like
can you imagine?
Exactly, right?
Little bacteria dancing to Madonna.
they're having the best time of their life in this toxic stuff.
Yeah, right. I'd call them aliens for sure.
Exactly. There's underwater volcanoes in the world, right?
Yeah.
These are called hydrothermal vents. There are bacteria and other life forms. This name I still remember from undergrad. It's called vestimentiferan worms.
Huh?
Yeah, there you go. So
it's kind of like his surname. No, I can't. can spell so it or pronounce it.
So these worms and these life forms actually depend on sulfur and sulfide. This is like if you and I go diving there, you breathe it, you're dead, right? Yeah, that's okay. Toxic. And but for me, those are the most alien life forms. Alien life forms that don't depend, life forms on Earth rather, that does not depend on oxygen, but other chemicals.
Cool. Well, there's your answer, Remy. Interesting stuff. Well, I think we could probably wrap it up for this episode, even though we have a ton of other questions to cover, just because I think we're out of time. And we also have a wine delivery that has just come and we really need to open one of those bottles.
We totally do.
Until the next episode, everyone. Thank you for sharing your information with everybody tonight.
Well, thank you. And so we'll meet you in another episode. I think we have questions on the same theme for another episode. Eh?
Yes, we do. Yes. The beginning of life on Earth. We shall continue on this topic.
So if your question was not discussed today, that'll be on next episode. From both of us, thank you very much. Subscribe to Zootopica and we'll see you next week.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.